explaining the Advaita philosophy or non-dual nature of this universe via quantum physics. In this presentation, first I will give a gist of quantum physics, then I will talk in detail about the double slit experiment, which forms the heart and soul of quantum physics. And from there, we will arrive at the Advaita philosophy and realize the non-dual nature of this universe. Before we delve into the subject, I will just mention about the three major disciplines of physics. The first one, quantum physics, describes the rules and behavior of particles at the smallest scale or the quantum scale. Next, classical physics explains the physical laws and behavior of objects in our everyday world, or we can say at the intermediate level. And finally, the theory of relativity, which deals with the behavior of objects at the largest scale. Apparently, the rules and behavior of objects are vastly different at each level, and not only they are different, but they seem to contradict with each other. But is it really true that our nature has different laws at different levels and which contradict with each other? Well, many scientists genuinely feel that they are missing some vital piece of information, and hence these mutually contradictory theories. And they are seriously looking for a common theory, the theory of everything, to clear the confusion. Yes, quantum physics isn't the easiest branch of physics, even for the pioneers of the field. Let's listen to what the great scientists have said about this cutting-edge science. If studying quantum mechanics does not make you dizzy, you haven't understood it. None other than Niels Bohr, the father of quantum physics. If you are not completely confused by quantum mechanics, you do not understand it. John Wheeler. Quantum mechanics makes absolutely no sense. Roger Penrose. I think it is safe to say that no one understands quantum mechanics. The great Richard Feynman. But despite all that, the mathematical models of quantum physics seem to be working perfectly well in predicting the events of the quantum world. So the students are advised to shut up and calculate rather than try to understand the actual science behind the mathematics. There exist many different interpretations of quantum mechanics, the most popular being the Copenhagen interpretation. That basically attempts to describe how particles and objects appear to behave at the quantum scale. According to this Copenhagen school, apparently a particle exists at multiple locations simultaneously. For example, a photon can exist here, it can exist there, and also on the moon at the same time. Next, a particle travels via multiple paths simultaneously. It is like when a photon travels from Chennai to Mumbai, it passes via Bangalore, via Hyderabad, via Kolkata, and also via the moon and the sun at the same time. Then, a radioactive atom can be both decayed and undecayed, a cat can be both dead and alive, a door can be both open and shut, etc. at the same time. That is to say, things can exist in multiple states at the same time. And then wave-particle duality, which states that things can behave as both waves and particles depending upon how we see them. For example, when we don't look at a photon, it apparently behaves like a wave and exists in multiple locations all over the space. But the moment we look at it, its wave function apparently collapses and settles to just one location, like a particle. And then quantum entanglement, superposition, and so on and so forth. There exist many such counterintuitive notions in quantum physics. But why did the physicists come to those strange and radical conclusions that made no sense to them? Because that's what the experimental results implied to them. And what is that experiment which changed their thinking so radically? It is double slit experiment, probably the most important experiment in science. Thomas Young, a British physician turned physicist, conceived and devised this experiment in early 1800s to see whether light behaved like waves or particles. And this is what Richard Feynman, the most liked quantum physicist, said about this experiment. All of quantum mechanics can be gleaned from carefully thinking through the implications of this single experiment. Here is the setup of the double slit experiment. There is a light source or photon gun which fires photons. Then there is a screen with two slits, and behind this is a photosensitive screen that detects and records the impacts of the photons. As the light source fires the photons, some of them pass through the slits and hit the photosensitive screen behind. And we study the pattern that develops on the detector screen. The concept is as simple as that. Before we see what happened with light photons, let us see how things like particles, bullets, grains, etc. behave in this experiment. As we fire them, obviously some particles pass through one slit and some pass through the other slit, and they produce two bands on the detector screen. Basically, as we fire particles, each particle will pass through only one slit and not both of them. Now let us see how waves behave in double slit experiment. In contrast to particles, each wave passes through both the slits and emerges two small daughter waves on the other side of the screen. These daughter waves interfere with each other and produce a pattern of alternate light and dark bands on the detector screen. That is because as the daughter waves interfere with each other, at some places they get cancelled and at some places they become prominent. So waves produce alternate light and dark bands on the detector screen in contrast to particles, which produce just two bands. Now we come to our light photon story. When photon particles were fired in DSE, as we can see here, they produced the pattern of alternate light and dark bands, which is a characteristic of waves. So photon particles appear to behave like waves, which implies that each photon particle travels through both the slits simultaneously. And what if there are more slits? Waves obviously will pass through all the slits, but shockingly, even the photons seem to go through all the slits. That implies each photon particle travels via all possible paths simultaneously like a wave. How can we explain this odd behavior of photons? Well, to understand this, we will turn our attention to water particles. Imagine that we undertake the double slit experiment with water particles. For this, we have a water gun, a screen with two slits, and a detector screen that is capable of detecting and recording the impacts of water particles. Now we shoot water particles one by one, as we did with light photons. After we shoot enough of them, we look at the pattern on the detector screen. It is no surprise that we see two bands corresponding to the two slits. This is obviously what we would expect from particles in our everyday world. Now let's place our whole setup inside a large container of still water and repeat the experiment. What kind of pattern would you expect now on the detector screen? Here we are. Interestingly, we don't get the previously noted particle pattern or the two-band pattern despite the fact that we have fired the water particles exactly as before. Instead, we get interference pattern that is characteristic of waves. How could that happen? Well, each water particle that gets fired initiates a tiny wave in the water tank, and this tiny wave passes through both the slits and produces the interference pattern on the screen. So what made the particle pattern vanish here and give way to the interference pattern or wave pattern? Obviously, it is the water environment which is responsible for the appearance of the wave pattern. Outside the water environment, we have seen that they have produced only two bands. Now the question comes, if water environment could make water particles to produce wave-like interference pattern, what could make photon particles produce the same? It must obviously be a photon environment. So the fact that photons cause interference pattern in DSE implies that our world is immersed in an ocean of photons. So when we fire a photon, it would initiate a tiny wave in the ocean of photons, which would then travel through both the slits and produce the interference pattern on the detector screen. Now it is no surprise that photon particles produce wave-like pattern in DSE if we propose that our universe is immersed in a notion of photons. Thus, DSC provides a direct proof of existence of cosmic ocean of photons, or we can call that as ether or Brahma Padarth. And unlike what the quantum physicists believe, a particle as such does not pass through both the slits, but it is the wave generated by the particle which passes through both the slits. Apart from solving the double slit puzzle and demystifying the quantum mechanics, this photon universe model explains so many other mysterious phenomena in simple and clear terms. For example, we can explain gravity. Just like how an object spinning in water creates a whirlpool and draws objects, Earth spinning in the ocean of photons could attract and draw objects towards it. So gravity is no longer a mystery. Similarly, we can explain the so-called electromagnetic waves in simple and clear terms. They are nothing but waves in the ocean of photons. They are no different from the water waves in an ocean of water, as simple as that. But our science textbooks describe them as self-propagating electric and magnetic fields oscillating in perpendicular planes in vacuum. No one can understand what that really means. Next, we can explain the so-called redshift and cosmic microwave background radiation, etc., and dispense with the theory of Big Bang. And finally, it is very likely that the so-called Higgs particle or God's particle is nothing but just our photon. Clearly, the cosmic ocean of photons or photonic ether provides a rational explanation for the interference pattern produced by photons. But this wave-like pattern occurred not only with photons, even electrons and many other particles were also shown to behave in the same way. That is, they also produced wave-like interference pattern in DSE. Now, how do we explain that? Do we need to propose the existence of a cosmic ocean of electrons? Not at all. The same photon model would explain how electrons could produce wave-like pattern in DSE. I have explained all that in detail on my blog. Basically, all the different particles and objects in nature can be described and conceived as different waves or different patterns of vibrations in the photonic ether. They are like different waves in a pond of water. When you see an electron, there isn't a separate physical entity called electron. It is just a specific pattern of vibration of the ether medium. In other words, it is just a wave in the photonic ocean. Likewise, as a football, it is just a wave, albeit a bigger and complex wave with overtones. So, because all objects and particles are nothing but waves in ether ocean, it is not a surprise that they can produce wave-like pattern in double slit experiment. Next, double slit experiment with cameras near the slits. Apparently, when scientists put some detectors near the slits and try to observe through which slit each photon was going through, the wave pattern disappeared and particle pattern emerged. And this led to the mind-blowing conclusion of quantum mechanics that we talked about in the beginning. When photons are not observed, they behave like waves, but when someone looks at them, they behave like particles. Now, how can we explain that? Why would the wave pattern disappear when we place cameras near the slits and try to observe the photon's path? Basically, the appearance of wave pattern or particle pattern in DSE is not an all or none phenomenon. Depending upon the setup of the experiment, we may get a purely particle pattern or a purely wave pattern or a combination of particle and wave patterns. And neither the wave pattern is specific to waves nor the particle pattern is specific to particles. It all depends upon how we set up the experiment. By doing some adjustments in the experimental setup, we can make water waves produce particle pattern and also make light waves produce particle pattern. How to make waves produce particle pattern? 1. Decrease the distance between the source and the screen. 2. Make the slits narrow and deep. 3. Increase the distance between the slits. 4. Bring the detector screen closer to the first screen. And last but most important, decrease the sensitivity of the detector so that it only senses the strong impacts and not the weak impacts.
And if we do that, surely water waves will produce particle pattern, and even light waves will produce particle pattern. Now, how to make particles produce wave pattern? Just do exactly the opposite. Increase the source to the screen distance, make the slits wide and shallow, make the slits closer to each other, and take the detector screen farther away from the first screen, maybe to the infinite. And last and most important, make the screen highly sensitive. That is, it must pick up even the most subtle impact. And if we do that, we can make even our water particles to produce wave pattern outside the water environment. And even bullets and footballs, etc., would produce a wave pattern. So, how the detector screen feels something or what pattern the detector screen shows depends upon the setup of the experiment and its sensitivity. Quantum physicists are right here in a way. The same thing may appear as a wave or as a particle depending upon the circumstances and how we look at it. So, waves can be seen behaving as particles and particles behaving as waves. And that begs the question, are they both different at all? Are there really two things called waves and particles in nature? Now we are getting closer to the truth and able to smell the non-dual nature of this creation. True, there is only one thing at the most subtle level that exists as waves, and at the gross level the same manifests as material objects or particles. We may see a ball here, but it is actually a wave in the ether ocean at a more fundamental level. While the gross material form of the ball exists at just one location, its subtle waveform exists all over the space. But to appreciate the subtle waveform, we need to retune our body and mind and make ourselves more sensitive. Now, how to make ourselves more sensitive so that we can appreciate the subtle signals and feel the wave nature of things? Remember the modifications we have done in the double slit experiment to reveal the wave nature of things, and exactly we need to apply them here to our body and mind. And that's what the Raja Yoga and other yogic practices call for. The yogic path to enlightenment. Distance yourself from the material world or keep away from the signal pollutions of the modern society. Then heighten the sensitivity of your sense organs by yoga diet, asanas, pranayama, etc. And broaden your perspective and deepen your thinking. And lastly, heighten the sensitivity of your mind by practicing meditation. And there probably exist numerous other ways. This is what we have just talked about. This picture illustrates the application of the principles of double slit experiment to our own body and mind in order to make ourselves appreciate the wave nature of things. So yes, it is theoretically possible if one follows and practices the yogic path, one will be able to sense the subtle wave nature of material objects. And because each object exists everywhere in wave form, one can sense all the things in this universe from wherever one is, and thus can sense the whole universe at once. As one starts sensing the wave nature of things, one will realize all the different worldly things, including oneself, as just vibrations of the same divine substance that we talked about. And with the enlightenment that follows, material world becomes the least interesting thing. One would realize that death is not something to be dreaded of, rather one would happily walk through it. At this stage, one loses one's material identity and attains moksha or union with the Paramatma and experience what is called as bliss or Brahmanandam, a state of eternal happiness. Thank you.